armies have marched against her. Great empires have sought to possess her totally. Her walls and streets are a pathway to her strange fortunes of the past. Hatred dominates the history of the city named Peace. Yet in Jerusalem, heaven's greatest love was expressed and displayed on Calvary. Jerusalem, where empires die. This series, shot entirely in the Holy City, asks the question, will America die at Jerusalem? Now, author, teacher, Dr. Lester Summerall.
This is a very special series of studies regarding Jerusalem, where empires die. I've traveled all through the Orient, and all the ancient cities had walls around them. And in the Near East here, it is the same. Jerusalem has been tremendously marked by its walls and by its gates. Its gates have been a very dominant factor in the history of Jerusalem. And even the Bible speaks very eloquently regarding those gates. For example, in Psalm 122 and 2, it says, our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem. David was so wanting and desiring, you know, to be within the city of Jerusalem in its gates. And in Psalm 48 and 12, it says, walk about Zion, go around about her, tell of the towers thereof. You have to move in and out of her gates in order to do that. In Psalm 87 and 2, it says, the Lord loveth the gates of Zion. That's the gates we're going to take you through today. We'll take you through all the gates of Jerusalem. And more than all the dwellings of Jacob, God loves the gates. Well, if God loves the gates, let's have a look at them then. It says that Jehovah loves the gates of Zion. As you go in through those gates, you will discover that Jerusalem is the smallest capital city on the face of the earth. The Bible says she is enclosed by her walls and by her gates. Jerusalem only covers about 2.5 square miles, and 1/6 of this is what is called the temple area, and that makes it a most important place. We enter in through her gates. The gates of the city of Jerusalem could actually embrace the total story of the human race. That's an amazing thing. History is written into those walls. It has 35 towers and 8 gates at the present time. The gates of Jerusalem have witnessed more war, more blood, more destruction than any other spot on the face of Mother Earth, of the planet Earth. There are 11 gates in the outer wall of the city. 7 of these are open that I'm going to take you through. One is not open, and we're going to take you to that one also. Others are blocked up from various time periods, stone blocks and rubble, and some with concrete. There are also 11 gates entering into the temple area, the Haran, the Mosque of Omar. 3 on the north and 8 on the west. And although these massive iron gates are up to 25 feet high, only small doors cut into these massive portals are open to the temple area for people to enter into. They're all closed at sundown, and no one can go in through those gates anymore. There are many legends about the gates of the city of Jerusalem. One is that there is a gate to hell from one of the city's gates. Another is that paradise is entered in through the city's golden gate. Another is that Damascus, the gate on the north that we will be taking you to, is the absolute center of the planet Earth, the center of the world. Think for a moment of the people who have entered in through the gates of this city, through the gates of Jerusalem, the prophets, the kings, the conquerors, the pilgrims, the Savior. No more illustrious group has ever, in the history of mankind, has ever walked through any city that has walked through the gates of Jerusalem. Nothing is more exciting to me than the gates of the city of Jerusalem. They're so exciting. And I know that you're going to enjoy, maybe more than anything you've ever known, is for you to walk with me right through all these gates. I'll give the name of the gate as we walk through them, and you yourself will then know the entrances and the exits of the world's most amazing, remarkable, and miracle city, the city of Jerusalem. Now, if you're ready, I'm ready. So why don't we go together and walk through the gates of that city? It will be exciting. Nothing is set up. All the people that you see are people that are unaware of television. And so as we walk through the gates of the city, you will see the people that are native to this place and that do their merchant work here and live in this place, and they're going about their regular duties as you and I walk through the gates of the city of Jerusalem. So if you're ready, well, so am I. So let's walk together through the gates of the city of Jerusalem. The Jaffa Gate is located on the western wall of the city of Jerusalem. It was one of those gates that was opened by the Six-Day War. Otherwise, it had been blocked up. It is open toward the Mediterranean Sea to the west and the cities of Jaffa and Haifa and Tel Aviv. The opening of this gate required East and West Jerusalem to be united again. The Israeli tore away the concrete fortifications and the derelict houses and made it a great highway up to its very entrance, leading from the sea all the way here. Herod's palace was by this gate, and so is David's tower, and it is one of the important entrances into the city of Jerusalem. Through this gate, emperors have ridden, through this gate, generals have ridden. It is one of the important entrances into the great city of Jerusalem. And today it is a city, it is a gate where all peoples can walk through this gate. There no one is forbidden to go through. It is not a limited entrance into the city. And so we just urge all of us to know that this important gate, and they call it the Jaffa Gate because it faces Joppa down by the sea. And so it is called by this name because of the direction with which it faces the city by the Mediterranean Sea. And this would be the first gate they could enter when they would come east into the city of Jerusalem when they were coming up the hill. And so this is the beautiful Jaffa Gate. It is a very wide entrance. It is the widest entrance of all the gates. And very few of the gates can have automotive traffic and also pedestrian traffic. All of them have pedestrian traffic, but this one has automotive traffic. Only two or three of the gates do have automotive traffic into them. And this makes it a very important gate. And as you can see, the people of all nationalities and countries move around you here as they go in and out of this gate. The pilgrims are here, the army is here, and all kinds of people that are walking through these gates. And so we hope that you have enjoyed one of the very lovely and the very beautiful gates of the city of Jerusalem. This is what is called the Zion Gate. It's a newly opened gate for Jerusalem, opened at the 1967 war. This gate faces south to Mount Zion. It is so narrow that we had to go backwards and forwards and backwards and forwards two or three times in order to squeeze a car through this gate. This gate is also known as a gate of the prophet David because his burial place, his sepulcher, is just to the outside of this gate. I had stood by this gate when Jordan occupied the city, and the Israeli soldiers were on a wall close by this church here, and I've seen the Israelis throw packages of cigarettes across to the Jordanians on this side as an act of friendship. But this gate was a closed gate until the Israelis, after the war, opened it up for the general public. It is called the Zion Gate because it is on Mount Zion on this side, and because it is where King David is buried, and makes it a very important gate. So come, let us go and see another one of the beautiful, wonderful gates of this city. There are seven open gates into the city of Jerusalem, and we are now at what is called the Dung Gate. The Dung Gate is on the south wall facing Bethlehem. It is near the Wailing Wall, which is just back of me in this area, adjoining the temple area. It is extensively used at this present time with thousands of people coming to see what is the western wall of the ancient temple in Jerusalem. It is an old gate, as you can see, and it faces to the southward toward Bethlehem. It's called the Dung Gate for the simple reason that refuse was brought from the temple area and dumped into the valley here. And so for many centuries, the name of it, of course, was the Dung Gate. The most religious people in the world pass through this gate, and because this is their entrance and exit to the Wailing Wall or the Western Wall. Tens of thousands of tourists also come through these gates, and also it has a great fascination for the local people to go in and out of this gate. The taxis are lined up in all directions here. They're always here, and the people use this gate. So gates are a place of communication. Gates are the place where people go in and out. And here in this great city of Jerusalem, the gates are a very important part. The gates open up into different sections of the city, like the Christian area, or the Muslim area, the Armenian area, and so forth, the Jewish area. This would be opening up into the Jewish area at this place here. The other gate that we just looked through, it opens up in the Armenian area. We would be going to one that opens up into the Muslim area. And so these gates are significant in so many aspects, and they're very exciting. Many, many things take place in the gates of the city. And so we're glad to take you through what is called the Dung Gate of the city of Jerusalem. The Bible says in the Psalms that God loves the gates of Zion. These are the gates of Zion. This gate here is called the New Gate. It could be called the New Gate because it was opened in 1967 by the Israelis. This gate was all blocked up solid, as you can see across here, because just over the way to this building, it was operated by the Israelis. That was their part. And so this had to be blocked up for the security of the people back in this way. And so after the war, when the Israelis occupied the old city as well as the new city, then they opened up the new gate. And so it's a new gate simply because it's recently opened for the public to move in and out. It's also a busy gate. They bring commerce in and out of this city, out of this gate here. And it becomes a very important area. The more exits you have to a city like this, you know, the better it is for the people from that community on the inside to do their business in and out of the gates. It relieves the congestion of the area in order to have the gates open for the people to do business as they go in and out of them. So among all the gates that we are visiting here, seven of them are open gates. One of them is a closed gate. We'll tell you about that when we get there. But in this gate here, it was opened by the war of 1967, that when the Israelis occupied this part of the city, then they tore out the old and ancient blocks that were placed here to cover up the gate and open it for commerce. And so that's the operation of going in and out of the gates of Jerusalem. And Jesus, the psalmist David said that God loves the gates of Jerusalem. And so this is one of his loves right here. And I'm sure that you enjoy seeing it. We are at the most populous gate in the great city of Jerusalem. The psalmist said, "Our feet shall stand within thy gates, O Jerusalem." The gates played the most important part in a city's life in the olden days. It was their ramifications for security. It was the place where politicians discussed matters of state. It was a place where business was transacted. You sold a piece of ground, or you married a woman. It was a very, very important gate. The Damascus Gate here faces directly north. That means it faces the city of Damascus, and therefore it's called the Damascus Gate. All the marching legions of the world empires came north to conquer this city. It was the great gate open to the northland, and it's the smooth way to come. And today, as you can see, it is a gate greatly used and for traffic. And it's one of the more ornate gates. Inside those gates are steps where you can go up on top of the wall and walk back and forth on the wall. And the people of this city, especially the people that live in what we call East Jerusalem, this is their gate for going in and out. When you walk a few feet inside the gate, the stores begin, and they are forever there, one right after the other. So there's a big business that goes on in the gates and just outside of the gates of Jerusalem. One of the most exciting gates in the city of Jerusalem is this Damascus Gate. And we are simply thrilled to take you through a gate that we have went through many, many times. If you could see the close-up of the metal gates that open and close, you would see the bullet marks of many times of fighting, many times of war, and it still leaves its indentations in the steel gates of the great Damascus Gate. And I would like to say, God loves the great gates of Jerusalem, and you must learn to love the gates of Jerusalem also. What a joy it is to walk in and out of those gates. I am now walking toward the Herod's Gate in the Jerusalem wall. As the sign says above here, it is the way to the Via Dolorosa. That is the way of pain or the way of sorrow. Of course, these gates are closed when the sun goes down or in the early evening. And in this gate, which is called the Herod's Gate, it's in the north wall of the city, facing toward Damascus. For many years, it was sealed. For many centuries, it was sealed. This gate was reopened upon the conquest of Jerusalem during World War I in 1917. It was once called the Sheep Gate. For many years, the weekly sheep market was held just outside this gate, where today it's full of automobiles. This name comes down from the time of Nehemiah, when it was called the Sheep Gate, and it is not known how this gate was changed over from the Sheep's Gate to be called Herod's Gate. It has no relationship to the Roman period, and has no relationship to the Romans whatsoever. These are the entrances, as you see great business going in and out of here at the present time, and it has to do with the people doing their business on this end of town using this gate, rather than going all through one gate, which would be a total impossibility, I can assure you. But this old gate has its place in history, and it is today called Herod's Gate, that has to do with the traffic of the city, especially in East Jerusalem, going back and forth. It is not as important a gate as the other gates we've shown you, but it's a very necessary gate for commerce and for convenience, for the city. The Bible says that God loves the gates, and it's a great privilege and a joy to bring you to the gates of Jerusalem and say of these gates that you used to be the fortress of the city and the power of the city, and that you are now open for the common people, for the civilians, to go back and forth through the gates of the city to carry on their lives. One of the greatest gates in the city of Jerusalem is the one that we are at this time looking at. And this gate is called St. Stephen's Gate. It has been known as the Lion's Gate because of the lions on the side of it that are engraved in it. And it's also been known as the Sheep Gate because outside the gates at one time they had times when they were selling a sheep. This gate on the inside is the beginning of the Via Dolorosa, the way of pain, the way of sorrow, in which the Lord Jesus Christ gave his life, and he pulled his cross down this direction through the city. This gate faces the east in that this gate goes down into the place where Jesus prayed at night in the Valley of Gethsemane, facing the Mount of Olives over onto the side here. As you can see, it is a very busy gate, and some of the people are not very respectful of whatever one might be doing. And could care less whether you were doing the work of the Lord or anything else. I think that gives you a very beautiful illustration of the land in which Jerusalem is located and its gates. It is a place of turmoil. It is a place of confusion. It is a place where everyone would like to take advantage of another one. Until the Prince of Peace comes and restores this world into a place of peace and a place of order, this is the kind of disturbance that the world will have to look upon and understand. Through this gate, we understand that Stephen was dragged out of the temple area, which is just to my right down here, and that he was brought into this outside place, and somewhere in this area right here became the first martyr of the Church of the Lord Jesus Christ. So that makes this a very sacred place, of course. Just inside the gate is the beginning of the way of the cross, where the Lord Jesus took his cross to Calvary. And so this gate is possibly more important to us than the other gates in that it has a direct relationship to our salvation, a direct relationship to our Lord who gave his life that we might be saved. In and out of the gates, great men have come. Generals have come. The mighty men of the ages have come. They have marched through these gates. And the last one that will ever go through them will be the Lord Jesus Christ himself as the King of Kings and the Lord of Lords as they move through the gates of the city of Jerusalem. With great joy, I have now walked with you through seven open gates of modern Jerusalem. These gates are marked in very remarkable ways. Some of them are strictly Arab gates. It doesn't mean that anyone cannot walk through them. It only means that that's the area where the Muslims live. Some are Jewish gates. Not that just the Jews use it, but it's so near to their operations and whatever they're doing. And I presume you could say, and there are Christian gates. The three great faiths of the world that believe in one God are in this great city, going in and out of these gates. Every political belief on the face of this earth walks in and out of these gates. This is the most unusual city that the world has. It is an amazing and an exciting city to be around. But this gate that you are observing now, I cannot take you through that gate. I cannot go through that gate. As you can see, it is a closed gate. It has a number of names. It's called the Eastern Gate because it faces the east. Just below me here is the place where the Lord Jesus Christ went into the Garden of Gethsemane. And from it and up the mountaintop is the Mount of Olives. The Mount of Olives is 150 feet higher than the highest point over here in Jerusalem, and you look down magnificently in the city. And the Golden Gate, or the Eastern Gate, they call it golden because of the when the sun hits the side of the city here, it is almost like gold. It's also the beautiful gate. There, 2,000 years ago, and there was a magnificent road that ran across this valley and over onto the Mount of Olives. And it was through this gate that the Lord Jesus Christ entered into this city when thousands of people followed him and cried, "Hosanna, thou son of David," as he rode on a donkey up this little incline here and in through these gates. The great temple area is just behind this wall through these gates. And so after the day of the birth of the church, Simon Peter and John came through these gates and found the lame man. And just inside these gates is where the first miracle of the newborn church took place. It was there that it sprang forth upon the stage of human history, not as a babe, but full grown. Here's where they began to feel the majesty when the Master said over on the Mount of Olives, "Go into all the world and disciple all nations." Ooh, what a command, what a challenge, and these gates remain that challenge. You say, why are they blocked in with stones? Because there was a Muslim leader who heard that when the Messiah comes, he will enter in through those gates, and then this city will belong to the Jewish people again. He says, I'll stop that, I'll block up the gates. And so they have been blocked for a long time. Not that anyone at this moment would believe that. We realize that when the Messiah comes, the new highway will be built, the gates will be open, and it shall be done, just as it has been prophesied, that it shall come to pass. But this gate remains closed. It's possibly the most beautiful of the gates that stand so high and lofty here above the terrain below it. Tens of thousands of tourists and pilgrims pass below it and look upon the wall and see the outline of the double gates, the twin gates. We believe that Jesus Christ will come, that the Messiah of the human race will come, and that he will bring to this world peace. We live in a tragic world. All around us, even since we have been in Israel this time, it has been tragedy. It's tragedy. Terrible tragedy. Not that we should enumerate them, but we have felt the tragedy. We have felt the sorrow in the heart of the Israelis. We have felt the sorrow in the heart of the Arab. It is a land that pulls, and it doesn't know which way to pull. Opposite directions. But you know, neighbor, it can be the same in your own life. You can be a personal tragedy. Not that you want to be, but there are elements in this world. You know, alcohol can destroy you and destroy your family. Drugs can destroy you, destroy your family. Illegitimate sex can destroy you and destroy your family. And sometimes just nonchalance, just a carefree spirit. The Bible says, how can a man escape if he neglect so great a salvation? All you have to do to be lost is to neglect God. Just neglect him. Just say, I don't want him. Maybe you need to come to the golden gate of God. Maybe you need to come to the gate of promise. Maybe you need to come to the one that can bring peace to your troubled heart, to your troubled soul. I'd like to, at this moment, invite you to come as an ambassador of the Most High God, as one who loves totally mankind. Won't you right now give your heart and your life to the Lord Jesus? What better place could you do it than at the gate of Jerusalem? And especially at the Golden Gate, especially at the Eastern Gate. Christ shall come from the east to save this world. And at this point, you could say, I receive him as my Lord and my Savior. No longer will I struggle against righteousness, against God, against holiness, but I surrender my life to him. If you do it now, it'll be the happiest moment recorded in your total life. It'll be a day that you will never forget and that you will always be thankful for. I trust you've enjoyed going in and out of the gates of the great city of Jerusalem. The Bible says in the Psalms, God says, and I love the gates of Jerusalem. I'd like to join him and say, as Jehovah loves the gates of Jerusalem, so I love the gates of Jerusalem. And we hope that you at this time will be tremendously blessed of God through the gates and through the Savior that's coming into your heart. Thank you so much. Think for a moment of the people who have entered in through the gates of this city, through the gates of Jerusalem, the prophets, the kings, the conquerors, the pilgrims, the Savior. No more illustrious group has ever, in the history of mankind, has ever walked through any city and has walked through the gates of Jerusalem.
For an audio cassette of today's program, send $5 or more to Lassie, Box 12, South Bend, Indiana, 46624. Please mention the program number on your screen. This program was made possible by private contributions to Lassie. This has been a Lassie Broadcasting Network production.